remembered how great my grandmother was and how great God must have been in that very short moment. This is the third Sunday in Lent. We have been a bit remiss because we've been celebrating. We had our Chinese New Year celebration, and then last week we honored our Black history, and so now we're going to do a little catching up on our Lenten series called Gifts of the Dark Wood. Gifts of the Dark Wood is about seeing life through new eyes. When we allow ourselves to accept this journey through the dark woods, then the Holy Spirit has an opportunity to nudge us and awaken us to a fuller life. We know that life is busy and messy and uncertain. But if we can look at it as not a problem to be solved, but instead that the entire journey, right, is opening us up to new possibilities, that even these uncomfortable times can actually help us to let go of all the things we can't know and live life more wholeheartedly. There are times in life when we feel empty. We've all been there. Like there's nothing left in the gas tank, and that can come from all kinds of things, being too tired or being stressed. Maybe we're dealing with grief or that feeling of worthlessness that we all get from time to time, wondering if we're making a difference in the world. Definitely a dark woods time. But what if we were able to let go of some of our obsessing about worthiness and surrendered into the idea that if we want to be filled, then at some point we have to empty ourselves and make room for God. We know that even Jesus felt empty despair at one time, and that it was a moment that God's possibility of life came alive, that the end of pain was revealed. The gift of the dark wood that we're going to be talking about this morning is the gift of being thunderstruck, a word I really like. I grew up in Colorado, and if you've really never seen weather until you've lived in a place like that. Colorado, I mean, Denver gets all the kudos for being a mile high city, but Colorado Springs is higher at 6,800 feet. And it sits right at the base of Pikes Peak in the Rocky Mountains. And storms come over those mountains so fast that they're hard to even predict accurately. John Denver sang a song, I think it was in Rocky Mountain High, where he said he had seen it raining fire in the sky. And I know exactly what he saw to make him use those words. You know, lightning bolts flashing in these swirling reds and oranges that ride on the wind of an afternoon storm. It's an amazing thing to see, and it helps me understand why ancient people, ancient tribes, thought God was in those thunderstorms. You know, it's raw power, isn't it? That's what being thunderstruck feels like lightning flashing or wind blowing or thunder crashing. I imagine we've all had something happen in our lives that made us feel that way, you know, something that took our breath away, made us speechless, and as we searched for words, all we could come up with was, wow. You know, that's happened a couple of times for me. Sometimes the wow has been a good wow. Sometimes not such a good wow. Life has a way of throwing those sucker punches at us sometimes, you know, those unexpected blows that take the wind right out of us. Listen to the thunder of God's voice, wrote Job. And what could be more human than being stopped in your tracks by nature, by the immensity of nature, that sense of reverential awe that for ancient people meant a message from the divine. Now you and I might consider that, you know, God's voice being in the thunder a superstitious kind of thing or a silly kind of thing, but it might actually be useful as we think about how we negotiate the inner terrain of this dark wood that we're talking about. Imagine living in ancient times, right? You're trying to make sense of this world around you. We know a lot about it now, but then volcanoes and earthquakes, thunder and lightning, the power of the sea. There's something beautiful and terrifying about those things. And how could you not tremble in awe, right? And one of the translations of awe is fear. So it's true that ancient people may have created gods to give themselves some kind of sense of control over this hostile universe. But explaining where powerful forces like thunder and lightning come might not have been the point all the time, I think. Because it's also a way of describing an outer experience and an inner one at the same time. Describing an experience of God from the inside out. That's awe. That's raw power. It's the thing that can knock the wind out of you and render you speechless. I wish those were always positive experiences, but of course they're not. You know, we get fired at work, or we have the diagnosis of an illness. There's a fire, or a flood, or an earthquake, or a tornado. Something that changes our life in an instant, leaving us thunderstruck. I remember very clearly the moment I was told my son had cancer. It's like it happened a minute ago. That memory has never even faded a tiny little bit. Even at this moment, even knowing that my son is alive and well and almost 38 years old, I can still get nauseous when I think of holding him in my arms and wondering if he would live. But as I walked in that dark wood, I was never alone. God sent one person after another to reassure me, to strengthen me, to comfort me. God sent all the right doctors and surgeons and caring nurses that took as good care of me as they did Ian. My parents never left my side. My mother-in-law flew out to be with us. People I didn't even know called and offered plane tickets and places to stay near hospitals. People brought food, laid hands on my son. Someone told me recently that God does God's best work in the dark. That even the world was created in the midst of darkness and chaos. And my life is a testimony to that over and over again, as I'm sure many of ours are. During my separation and divorce, people were there for me in ways I could not have imagined. Again, I never felt alone. I never felt abandoned by God, but instead I felt embraced and covered by grace. The littlest things could get me through another day. You know, the sun peeking out through the clouds, you know, on the third cloudy day when I thought I was going to lose my mind, and suddenly the sun shines for a second, just giving me a little bit of something to hold on to. One day I was walking through the fellowship hall, and somebody came and grabbed my hand and put a scrap of paper in it. And on that paper was a little Bible verse that got me through another few months. Friends calling up, getting me out of the house when I had started to isolate myself. I can go on and on, but what I want for you to do is to remember your own times of being thunderstruck. Maybe by life, but then I hope by God reminding you that you're loved and you're embraced and you're cared for. And even in the midst of hunting for another job or awaiting test results or getting through divorce or drug addiction or alcohol, if we reach out a hand, God's hand is right there for us to grab hold of. God's right there helping to pull us out of the deep, like pulling Peter out of the stormy sea when he lost focus and began to sink. God is present through it all. You might use your journals this week if you haven't received one yet. There's some out in the hall, as well as our pedometers as we continue our healthy temple journey through Lent as well. But think about times this week when you were thunderstruck, when something came that rendered you speechless or breathless or shouting, wow. Think about times when you saw God in the midst of it, or if you didn't see God in the midst of it, that you were able to look back after and realize that God was present throughout it. Maybe nothing's ever gone wrong in your life. I hope that's true. But even if it hasn't, maybe there's been a moment of complete clarity or a moment when beauty took your breath away and you were awed by someone's generosity. A time when you were thunderstruck by God's presence, his unexpected grace. So take a minute to remember that this week and be grateful for those times when God showed up. And you walked away from that moment different than you were the moment before. One way that God is present to us is through communion. This holy time when we remember this gift of Jesus' life and the gift of his death so that we might be reconciled to the God Jesus wanted so much for us to know. As we take this small piece of bread today and dip it in the juice and swallow it all up, we're being reminded, we're being filled, we're being embraced by this awesome love and grace of God. We remember the story, we hear it all the time, about how Jesus had dinner with his best buddies that night. How they sat around the table eating the Passover meal together one last time. Jesus knew what was coming, but as hard as he tried, he couldn't get his disciples to understand. So they sat there unaware, but Jesus knew, and he knew they were going to run away and hide as soon as the trouble started. Judas would betray, and Peter would deny, and most of them would simply disappear. But even knowing all of that, Jesus loved them. And he took the bread on the table, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he shared it with his friends. And as he did, he asked them to remember him. And he took the leftover wine, he blessed it, he shared it, explaining that it represented his blood of the new covenant given for their forgiveness. He forgave them ahead of time, washing their feet, reminding them of his great love, telling them that he would put in a good word for them with his Father. But also calling them to carry on the ministry, to become his hands and feet in the world. He would be sending an advocate. He would be filling them with a spirit that would make them brave and strong and filled with power to spread the good news that Jesus had come and the people were saved and the victory was already won. There's a lot of power in that little piece of bread you are about to receive. So be thunderstruck, my friends. God is in the house.